welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of the prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose the reward. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Dear siblings in Christ, grace to you and peace from God, the Creator, our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Spirit of God that surrounds and fills us. Amen. Our gospel reading is one of a continuation of readings that we've been sharing from Matthew 10, but not everybody's been here, so I'm just going to back up a little bit. It's a long chapter. It's got lots of stories, but it's about Jesus sending the disciples out to share the good news. And so he tells them about their value. He tells them about the fact that God even has the hairs on their head counted. God knows so much about us and loves us with a crazy, passionate outpouring of love. So he says, have no fear. Nothing that is covered up now won't be uncovered. What's hiding in the shadows will someday see light. And he talks about hospitality. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the Heavenly Parent. It's an intimate, intimate text. And just a little point that I want to add, because we've been noticing this in this congregation for nearly a year now. Whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. Can also be read, whoever welcomes a just person in the name of justice will receive the reward of the just. There's so much integrity in this sending out the disciples with the liberating message of the gospel. And then he says, whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. I've been pondering this verse for years. And it has significance. Whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones. Now I know many of you are or have been parents. I remember when my kids were quite small and resisting bedtime, I need a drink was one of the best ways to get us to extend it just a little bit. goodness, my kid's thirsty. And I thought about this verse. And when I was in El Salvador, must have been 20 years ago already, a group of us with the Bishop of El Salvador were at the United States Embassy. And we were fighting against water privatization, arguing that water is a human right, arguing for justice for a very, very poor people. And when our daughter was in confirmation, and she also knew our friends from El Salvador, her project was to raise funds to take a solar-powered water purifier to her new friends. Because she said, Mom, it's not fair that I get to drink clean water and they don't. This is the logic of a child. 13. 12 maybe. And now we all drink bottled water if we can afford to. Because it has been privatized. Here. But that's not my point. My point is water is life. And Jesus puts life together with a little child in this reading. Whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones. And I notice what Jesus is doing here. Jesus' culture was probably more like that of my parents and their parents, where children ought to have been seen and not heard, or maybe not even seen. You know, the neighbors come over to visit, and the parents say, scram, we've got grown-up talk to do. And of course, we wouldn't scram, we'd listen around the edges, because if it's grown-up talk, we should be listening in. Well, here's the grown-up talk that Jesus invites to children. He sees you. He hears you. You know, the Pharisees used to argue with Jesus that he ate with sinners and tax collectors and all the people around the rough edges of society. The people that many go out of their ways not to see. And children were part of the least of these. The least of these. And Jesus says, nobody is the least of anything. Unless they self-promote, and they're pompous, and they think they're first in this world, they've gotten their reward already. But for those who struggle to be seen, Jesus says, I see you. If you have friends who have turned their back on you, and you feel alone, Jesus says, I see you. You're dealing with hard stuff that you don't think anybody's going to understand. He sees you. Even the smallest child. He sees you. Because when you feel like you are the least of these. You're not. In fact, you might just be first in the kingdom. How's that sound? A little boost for you? And through the waters of holy baptism, through the water of the Word, we are gifted by God. Gifted with God's Holy Spirit. This, I think, is why Jesus says you must become like a little child to enter the kingdom. I remember when we first moved, and some of you have heard this story, we first moved to West Bend, Wisconsin. And the kids were pretty young. I think Christina was in fourth grade, and David was 4 or 5. And this was a big church, and they had lots of big church rules and customs and habits. And I was going to a Christian Ed meeting where we were going to talk about the age of First Communion. So I'm surrounded by a group of people who did not have children of their own. Some of them had grandchildren, okay? And I wanted to talk to them about lowering the age of First Communion. Actually, lowering the age of communion in general. And one of them, rather huffily, said, "Well, what can a 5-year-old know about Holy Communion?" Well, it just so happens that our babysitter didn't make it in time for me to get to the meeting and leave David behind, so David had come with me. He was coloring over in the corner. I didn't think he was paying attention. But I said, "David, what do you know about communion?" He's just coloring away. He pauses and he looks up and he says, "Well, that's when you take the bread, which is the body of Christ, when you take the wine or grape juice, which is the blood of Christ." He was a very succinct kid. "And you eat them. And when they go into your tummy, your sins are all flushed away." And I thought, yeah, for a little kid, like, yes, that's not bad. Your sins are forgiven. And he also said, "When you take the bread, which is the body of Christ, when you take the wine or grape juice, which is the blood of Christ, and you eat them, then the body of Christ isn't broken anymore." And I thought, whoa, they didn't teach that to us in seminary quite that way. But it's true. When we come together for Holy Communion as the body of Christ, with Christ as our head, just for a short time, the body comes back together. We are remembered, reattached, and we have a glimpse of what the kingdom might look like if we all were part of the same body. The same bread, the same wine, the same Spirit of God, which comes to us in holy baptism. You see, even the smallest child has the Holy Spirit and has insights that haven't been argued out of them yet. There's an innocence about little children. And their parents and their loved ones do everything they can to make sure that their surroundings are safe. That they are safe. They are nurtured so that they might grow and thrive. That is what God does for us. Beginning in baptism, through our Christian relationships, through our experiences, the ones we learn from that we really didn't want to learn from, and the wonderful ones. Whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. My last point is, being a disciple of Jesus is not hard. You don't need a seminary degree. Those disciples that Jesus sent out were working people, fishermen, tax collectors. We don't know what most of them did. But they certainly did not have seminary degrees, but they did know about the liberating good news of Jesus. Jesus that leaves no one behind, no one oppressed, no one broken, because of his great love for the world. For you. And Jerry, thank you for providing me with water every Sunday. Your reward will be great someday. As will all those who put their neighbors first. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.